So three things today I'll discuss. Where is not, okay? So it is already written here. See in the notepad. See in the notepad, I already wrote. Last class I have discussed what is inference rule. Okay, what is inference rule? Now, so if for a given relation R, some functional dependencies you can directly found. Okay, so those will be called not what is that existing functional dependency. Okay, so anyone can derive as per the because we are familiar with the real world. So that's why let I gave a table employee. Okay, and the attributes are employee ID, employee name. Okay, then employee salary, employee address. Okay, so then something employee designation. If I give, then you can create the functional dependency between some attributes. Okay, like as you can see here, I can relate employee name to address. Okay, I can relate employee name to or employee name to designation or employee ID to other attributes. So I can relate them. So those are directly known to everyone will be a existing functional dependency. But some other functional dependency can also be derived through this inference rule. Okay, so its best inference rule will be transitivity. Okay, so if ID is deriving name and ID is what is that determining name and name is determining address, then ultimately ID will determine address. Okay, so those inference rules proposed by Armstrong. So there are six inference rules. What are those inference rules? The first inference rule is what? Reflexivity. Okay, so what is reflexivity? So see here, in case of the first one, IR1, what is IR1? It is reflexivity. Okay, IR1. Okay, so under IR1, so this will be reflexivity. Okay, reflexivity is only in case of trivial functional dependency. Reflexivity, if you are familiar with reflexivity, something called what is that in your PUC standard. Okay, so there is a concept of what reflexivity, some transitivity, then something called many relations are there. So relation is when you tell that function or the relation is reflexive relation. Okay, so reflexive property, it is a feature of a function. Okay, so reflexivity. Okay, so reflexivity is a property. Okay, reflection. Okay, it is coming from the name reflection. Okay, so reflexivity says what for a what is that, which relation or which functional dependency, trivial functional dependency. So let this is for a trivial functional dependency. This is only for trivial functional dependency. Okay, so what is trivial functional dependency? In case of trivial functional dependency, you can see here, if I write one example. Okay, what trivial functional dependency says? A, B can determine B or A. Okay, A, B can determine B or A. So this is trivial functional dependency. So this, in this case, in this trivial functional dependency case, okay, so in this trivial functional dependency case, both the functional dependencies are reflexivity, or it is satisfying reflexivity property. How? Now B is a subset of AB and A is a subset of AB. Okay, so this feature is called what? Reflection or reflexivity feature, or this is called inference rule one. Okay, so it means what? If now I'm telling one example, if this is given, a table is given. Okay, a table is given, example. Okay, example, a table is given. Now as per reflexivity feature, okay, a table is given, let student or employee, let employee is a table, EMP. Okay, so now see here, I am not telling any functional dependency. I am telling simply EID, okay, ename, okay, ename and salary. Okay, so let salary, three attributes I am telling. But remember, to find trivial functional dependency, you always take what? A relationship. Okay, so let the relationship, this is a table, but this indicates a relationship. Okay, so this is a relationship between employee and project. Okay, employee and project. So let, again I'm repeating, the example is employee project. It has some attribute like employee ID, employee name, salary, and project ID. Okay, project ID, and then project namelet, project name, simply two attributes I'm adding. Okay, so in this case here, if you apply this reflexivity feature, then first you identify which can be the candidate. The candidate will be the combination of EID and project ID. Okay, so EID and project ID, if it's the combination, then as for the reflexivity property, okay, so the determinant here in this table will be EID comma project ID, EID cam comma project ID, and as for the reflexivity property, the functional dependency will be EID project ID to EID, okay, and the same thing, EID project ID to project ID. This is the first functional dependency you can find, okay. Whether it is present or not, you can apply this reflexivity feature, okay, and you can derive at least two functional dependency existing in these two, in this table, okay. What is the name of the table? Employee project. This is not employee table, this is not project table, this is employee project table, or you can say it's a Workson table. It is keeping some attributes of employee, and also it is keeping some attributes of project, and the candidate can be, okay, on it's not candidate, the determinant can be combination of employee and project. So now I'm applying this reflexivity feature. So this is IR1. The second inference rule is, you can say, what is the second inference rule? So that is, I'm writing as IR2. So what is the second, what is that? Inference rule? The inference rule is, it is transitivity. Okay. So I'm moving to ask for the slide I'm explaining. Okay. Which one is there at the second? Okay. So first three, remember, it is reflexivity. Then wait, I told you to, okay, so augmentation, okay, so second is what? Augmentation. What is augmentation? If x to y, then xz to yz, okay. So from this, again I'm moving to notepad. So second is augmentation. So now you apply augmentation rule. What is augmentation? Augmentation, okay. So what is augmentation? Say, see, you can add. Augment means you can add. So given, what is the rule? Given, let there is a functional dependency existing A to B, then you can add in both sides. So this implies, this implication symbol, AC also will determine BC. So in both side I am adding C. So this is augmentation feature, okay. If X is I determining Y, then XZ will also determine YZ. So now if I apply this augmentation feature in this relation employee project, then how many already this is given? Okay, employee project, so I can add anyone. Okay, so let I'm augmenting this EID project ID to EID project ID. Okay, so let I'm creating one. Okay, so other than this, what is that? Trivial functional dependency. I'm taking one non-trivial functional dependency. Let EID project ID can determine let project name. Okay, so this one I'm copying. So here, so this is a functional dependency let existing. Then if you apply augmentation, so this will imply, here. This employee project in both side, I'm adding any one of the attribute. So this is augmentation. So employee project, I'm adding any one of the attribute, let E name, okay, let E name. Then this will also determine project name with E name. So this is what augmentation property, okay. So the first one is reflexivity, second is augmentation, and third one is IR3 is transitivity, okay. So same thing, IR3, okay. So IR3 is transitivity. So this says what? This is a simple definition. Okay, if there is a functional dependency existing A to B, there is another functional dependency existing B to C, and this will indicate what is that A to C. Now see here, how many functional dependencies already you have derived from for this particular table employee project? We have made two, what is that, as for the reflexivity, two functional dependency. Again, as for this augmentation, from these two, I made another functional dependency is existing. From this existing, I created another one. Okay, so now it is four. So now from this you can get let A to B, anywhere A to B you can find here. Let two existing functional dependencies are EID to let something E name. Okay, whether E name will identify some other attribute. Let E name is also unique. Okay, so let E name is also unique. Okay, there is no duplicate value I am allowing. Or at the time of creation, I made E name as unique. E name is not primary key. E name is unique. Okay, so then no employee name will be repeated. So that let this functional dependency is existing. EID to E name. Okay, and since E name is unique, so E name to salary. Okay, so two existing functional dependency I'm adding here. Okay, so two existing functional dependency I'm adding here. So one is EID and let ename is unique. So ename, okay, so this is possible. Another, this is first existing functional dependency. Another, since name is unique, so ename to salary I can get. So these two are existing, then this will indicates, okay, so EID to salary. EID to salary. So these are many here. How many? This is growing. The functional dependence set is growing. So these two are by inference rule. This is existing. Again, this is by inference rule. Okay. This is existing. And this is by inference rule. Okay. So some are existing, some are logically inferenced. Okay. So in this way, if you apply another three also, you will find many functional dependency or all possible functional dependency present in a particular relation. So that will be called as closure of that relation. Okay. So another three, I'm moving to PPT. See here, another three are not important. You need to remember these three. Reflexivity. Okay. It is as per trivial functional dependency, augmentation, transitivity. The next three, same thing, decompose. If there is a functional IX, let EID is determining fname and first name and last name, then EID can determine individually first name and EID can individually determine last name. Similarly, the reverse of decomposition is union. If EID is determining first name, EID is determining last name, then EID also will determine first name, last name. We are combining, remember it. This will help. Why you are combining? This will help to detect the candidate key. Similarly, pseudo transitivity, if X is determining Y and WI is determining Z, then this Y can be replaced by X, because Y is depending on X. So that's instead of Y, I can directly put X. So this will become WX to Z. So the last three are not important. The first three are very important. Reflexivity, then augmentation, and then finally, transitivity. Okay. So I told you last class, what is that called? Closure. Closure will be written by FA plus. This indicates all functional dependency. Those are existing and those are deriving by inference rule. Okay. And close, same thing, closure. This will be explained in the last part of the fourth module. Okay. We'll do some task. Okay. Remember the term closure. Then I'm moving to normalization. The next discussion will be normalization. Okay. So I remember the definition. What is normalization? We need to decompose to make the table better, to make a relation better. We need to decompose. How will you decompose? We'll apply the formula. Okay. Functional dependency formula. We'll identify which functional dependency from all functional dependency, we can identify which attribute is prime and which attribute is non-prime. Keeping all prime attributes together, separate the remaining non-prime attributes to another relation, we can easily decompose, provided there will be many conditions. The functional dependency must be partial. The functional dependency must be transitive. Okay, so these things usually create bad relation. We need to decompose. Okay, so this is the definition of normalization. Please read it. You need to explain this. The process of decomposing unsatisfactory bad relations by breaking up their attributes into smaller relation is normalization. Again, I'm repeating, the process of decomposing unsatisfactory bad relations by breaking up their attributes, prime or non-prime attribute, into smaller relations. Okay, so this will be this is a process. Then what is normal form? If you apply normalization, then the relation which is created by applying the process of normalization reaches a normal form. Okay, usually whenever we are creating a relation roughly, that is not relation. If you don't apply the formula of normalization, we will never say the relation is a normal form or not. If the relation is not in normal form, then we will never apply this thing in our application. So there are various categories of normal forms. This is in a, what is that? Approach, layered approach. Okay. So first, something like I am giving you police something. Likewise, you can see the workers, how they are finishing. They are giving the finish. What is that? The last work of a building while they are constructing. Okay. That is called polishing. Why? First, they are constructing everything. Then first phase of polishing, second phase of polishing. Then they are putting some marbles, then they are polishing, likewise. Okay, so 3-4 phases of polishing. So this normalization is not a single phase, it has many phases. First, it will say, if the relation is completely bad, then make it first normal form. If the relation is now moved to first normal form, then change to second normal form. If the relation is second, then make it to third normal form. Then make it to BCNF. Then make it to fourth NF. Okay. So remember, usually a BCNF normal form or the relation which is supported BCNF is one of the best relation. Okay. Fourth normal form is a special case where a special functional dependency, that is multi-value functional dependency, used. But until fourth NF, we'll utilize only functional dependency. In the beginning, only functional dependency. I told two kinds. Okay. One is the simple functional dependency, single arrow. One is double arrow, multi-value functional dependency. So multi-value functional dependency will cover in fourth NF. But until that, we'll study up to first, then second, then third NF, then BCNF. So BCNF normal form is better normal form, okay, to classify whether the table is better or not. Okay. So now slowly you do. If the normal form is not in BCNF, so then it will, okay. If the normal form is not in 3NF, you cannot apply BCNF. You cannot say, if I ask a normal form is not in 3NF, whether it will be a BCNF? No. A normal form is not in fast NF, whether it will be 2NF? No. If a normal form is 2NF, then definitely it is 1NF. If a normal form is in 3NF, then definitely it satisfies 1NF and 2NF. If a normal form is BCNF, then definitely it satisfies 1NF, 2NF, 3NF. But if anyone is broken, like normal form is not 2NF, then it will never be 3NF, it will never be BCNF. It will only be fast NF. So that's why slowly we'll move. We'll study how to make our relation different normal form. So it depends on, as per this functional dependency part. Okay, we'll go. Okay, what you have studied, this knowledge will apply. Okay, so what is the definition of normal form? Condition using keys and functional dependency of a relation to certify whether relation is in a particular normal form or not. We'll utilize, okay, for any particular normal form, you will utilize some functional dependency rule, okay, and some conditions. Okay, so now I'm moving to this 2NF, whatever it is. Okay, so now see 2NF, 3NF, and BCNF based on keys. Please remember, different normal form, 2NF, 3NF, and BCNF. Okay, these are depending on, these will depend on the functional dependence of a relation. Fourth NF will depend on multiple dependence, just I told. Then fifth NF will depend on joint dependence, please remember. Then what about fast NF? Fast NF will not related to any functional dependency. Okay, so it will relate to the, what is that? There is another things I told, that is called, what is that? Redundancy. Okay, so remember, before functional dependency, we have studied, the four informal design guidelines, the first one and the second one. Okay, the first one tell the name of the attribute. Okay, it's the semantics. The second one tell what? There should not be any redundancy. So if there is redundancy, that will be cleared by fast normal form. So all row must contain single value. Every row contains single value for every column. That is called atomic property. Okay. So that's why I'm classifying again. I'm repeating, out of different normal form, the first, it is not written. 1NF simply a basic normal form. 1NF, a relation will reach at 1NF if we remove the redundancy tuple or the redundant tuple. Remember it. So fast NF will never depend on any functional dependency. Okay. Fast NF will be, or any relation will reach at fast NF if we remove the redundant row by making the table atomic, by making the column value atomic. Two terms I'm using, one is redundant, one is atomic. The other real normalization or other normal form, like starting from 2NF, 3NF, and BCNF, they are based on keys and FDs. Fourth NF is based on same keys, but not FD. It is in MVD, please remember. It is multi-value dependency, okay? And fifth NF is based on same keys and another dependency, joint dependency. I'll explain joint dependency. So there are three kinds of functional dependency. A simple functional dependency, multi-value dependency, then joint dependency, okay? First normal form is based on no functional dependence. It is based on, redundant tuples, okay? So if you remove the redundant tuples, it will be 1NF. 2NF, 3NF, BCNF based on functional dependency. 4NF based on MBD, multiple dependence. 5NF based on joint dependency. Please remember, okay? So under this, we'll explain many things, whether the join is lossless or lossy join, whether the functional dependence after decomposition, they're preserving the same dependency or not. Two things are always important, because normalization based on decomposition, we cannot simply decompose, okay? Similarly, I am telling that there is a house and it is creating some problem. If you separate the house, then the problem will be solved. So simply, I cannot break the middle wall. Okay, I have to see here before how the for example, two rooms are there, how they are sharing okay space. The same thing must preserve. You cannot simply break randomly. Okay, indiscipline approach you cannot apply. So there should be a disciplined approach while breaking a table. Okay, while applying normalization. So that's why we need to see the after decomposition. We have to take care the join. Okay, must be lossless and all functional dependency existing initially must be preserved. Okay, so while decomposing. So now I'm moving to the fast NF. Okay, so these are something. Denormalization is the reverse process. Okay. If it is normalized, then you can make it denormalized to which is okay from here. Fast NF, if I apply normalization, it will be 2NF. 2NF, if I apply denormalization, it will become 1NF. It's the reverse. 3NF, if I apply normalization, it will be BCNF. BCNF, if I apply denormalization, it will be 3NF. Okay, it's a reverse process. So from higher to lower. Okay, so this is denormalization, usually never applied. Okay, so it's a concept simply. Okay, so because it's telling, because we are doing, so that's why you can reverse our approach also. So now moving to something key. Okay, so before to you know, you are familiar with this thing, what is candidate key? Anyone, any attribute in a relation which is unique, okay, so can be the candidate key, okay, and not null. So any one of the key will be chosen as primary key, the remaining key will be the secondary or alternate key. Example, in a student relation, okay, so let there are three attributes, chances they are not duplicate. For example, registration number cannot be duplicate, roll number cannot be duplicate, phone number cannot be duplicate. So these three can be the candidate key. I can pick anyone. Let I am picking registration number. So this will be the primary key. The others two, the phone number and the roll number, will be the secondary or alternate key. Please remember. Then what is key? You know, what is super key? The combination of many keys will be called combination of many attribute if identifying. Okay, the combination of many attribute if are behaving like determinant, then they will be the super key. Okay, and minimal super key is the primary key. Okay, so now see in this example, so this will be last class I told what is a candidate key. Now see here in this example, this employee ID project ID can be the super key. Okay, but in this case here EID can be a primary key. Okay, because there is no combination of attributes. So any key, so this primary key will be the minimal super key. Primary key can be also a super key because it contains only one attribute. So that's why it is called minimal super key. Usually super key consists of at least two attributes. But since this can be a key also, then you can say this primary key, or primary key is usually called minimal super key. A super key with less number of attributes. Okay. So remember, these are the terms.